we speak with the next generation of progressive candidates, activists, and organizations dedicated to restoring our democracy and protecting our civil rights and liberties. Make sure to stay tuned for Tuesday at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, right here on the Progressive Radio Network, to hear the most recent episode of our podcast, and follow us on social media and iTunes to stay up to date with everything millennial politics.
This is PRN, the Progressive Radio Network.
The Jazz Crusaders, they morphed later on, a couple of years later, into the Crusaders with Trans Dance. This is from their festival album, recorded live at the Newport and Pacific Jazz Festivals in 1966. This is Leid Stories. I'm Eutrice Leid, and this is going to be quite a week. So, as I would say in the Caribbean, band your belly for it. Get ready for it. We have some interesting things, interesting developments here, and we're going to talk about them now. Of course, on the schedule, not for today, but it would happen by Wednesday, we'll have the members of the Senate. I don't even know what to call this. It is so pitiful. It's such a pitiful effort. They're going to allow some testimony now that the main event is practically over. Now they will consider some testimony to see how that might line up with what they already know. So that is supposed to happen, and we're supposed to be on pins and needles about that, because you see, they still have a decision to make as to the innocence or guilt of one Donald Trump. You know, I don't know what they think they're doing, or what they think we think they're doing, but I'm fed up with it, and I'm clear. This is the reason why 20 years or so ago, I just washed my hands of voting and all of that, because I said, you know, this is not working. This is not a system that is designed to work. And it had to do specifically with the contempt, the open contempt that the apparatus of government seemed to have for so-called voters. I was a very enthusiastic voter, extremely enthusiastic. I always was at the polling site even before the people set up. And as the years went by, more and more insults to my intelligence, you know, decided in the voting booth at the time, they had voting booths at the time, I decided that I'd had it with this charade. I was just not going to participate in it. I will observe it and so forth, but I'm not part of it. It really, really is a shocking thing. And people are now getting to see it because it's so blatant and unapologetic, in your face, contempt. You know, I just don't understand how a country this great could even hope to continue to be a great country with this kind of thing happening, and total disregard, in the case of Donald Trump, total disregard for the rule of law, for, you know, what is expected of him, what he should be doing as the President of the United States. It's so sickening. And then we have, of course, the circle getting wider and wider, where people are adopting his attitudes. They seem pretty okay with him. And so you have a mess of a so-called trial going on in Washington, D.C., where before the public, they don't care anymore, not even to hide anything, because it is so embarrassing that this is the level that the highest levels of government are operating at. It is outrageous, and it is happening. But the idea is that they're supposed to at least fake it, that they are interested in democracy. So they'll give us a little taste of it. They'll give us a little taste of democracy, and they will decide that they're not going to call witnesses, carte blanche, but they'll call a couple, or, you know, one or two. And now that the meat of the trial is done with, they'll now see what else they could learn, as if they're going to do anything with the information revealed, as if they're going to call back the President of the United States and say, hey, how about this? We just learned this. What have you to say about this? He has nothing to say. He's going on with his life and taking a large chunk of believers with him. And we are left to observe. That's all we can do. There's nothing we can do other than that. So that's where things are in the great city of Washington, D.C. All right, so maybe I'll start off with a little observation. Hillary Clinton is not running, at least this is what she says, but yet she seems to be running. She's not running, but she's running. And she's running against Bernie Sanders and, to some degree, the Democratic Party as a whole, with no apparent objection from party leaders. She takes delight in expressing repugnant opinions about fellow Democrats, which one would think, you know, should be discouraged. You're not supposed to do that. And does so as if to suggest she's expressing widely held views within the party and has been given the green light to do so. But why is she being allowed to do these things? comes out and just blatantly attacks Sanders, says nobody likes him, and she's bitter, and she's nasty and caustic. And she's talking as if, well, we should be all okay with it. And apparently, in Washington, they're all okay with it. She should be called on the carpet by now and read something. You know, somebody should be reading her some kind of rights and saying, listen, your views are your views. But when you get up in front of the nation and you start vilifying people and making it appear that we're okay with it, we're going to have to encourage you to either stop it or we'll stop it for you. Which would you prefer? But it's the case for this Democratic Party. It is so annoying that they can't seem to just put your foot down on something. Have an opinion. Do something about the craziness that is happening all around you. But they all are just sitting there and they're watching Hillary Clinton go berserk. This is insane to me. I don't know any other country where this would be allowed. Your private opinions about Bernie Sanders are your own private opinions, and keep them that way. I don't know that you have some right to express yourself. Go express yourself. You know, go express yourself to Bill. He needs to hear you. Go express yourself to him. But she is doing this more and more, and it's becoming more and more irritating. And of course, it is damaging to the Democratic Party. It's as if they have no discipline, as if there are no rules, as if she has to be taught that this is not a good thing to do. If you like Bernie Sanders or you don't like Bernie Sanders or you're mad at Bernie Sanders because he clipped you, you were so sure you were going to win the election, and you are very angry with this man, go see a therapist. Do something to get your head clear. But then you have access to the media, and the fawning media is acting like they don't know what a story is. The story is not the fulminating Hillary Clinton talking about her anger still that she didn't win. And so she is going to use the resources of the party, use the media to her advantage now, all the while claiming that she's not running for office, but behaving like Trump. So I think something ought to happen to compel her to explain. What is this all about? What is this? This is, you know, of course, we'll hear her jump behind the free speech. You know, this is the land of free speech, and she's free to express herself. Just so happens that she wants to beat poor Bernie Sanders into a pulp because she lost. And now we see why. Her attitude stinks. She's wrong on many, many levels, and she should stop. And if she can't stop, then somebody ought to stop her. Because I notice Nancy Pelosi is very quiet. Democratic Party officials are kind of quiet. And they're letting her just do they're letting her be the female Trump. Do whatever you want to do. Say whatever you want to say. Insult people however you want. Tell lies even. about them and get away with it. This is regrettable. It is just unseemly conduct for an old woman like this to be operating like a gangster, a hoodlum. And she's going to go after Bernie Sanders and make him lose. That's what she wants to do. That's what she wants to do. Well, Hillary, this is the truth. You're no longer viable as a candidate by your own doing. You're not, as you try to portray yourself to be, the, you know, the angel out there, pure as the driven snow. You have a lot to explain, as a matter of fact. We could start with Benghazi, for example. We could start with Haiti. You and your husband and the pillaging, and your brother, and the pillaging of Haiti. We could start with there. We can go there. Just shut up. Shut up and go away. I guess that's her ultimate victory, that she's not going to go away. She has to be paid to go away. Well, I certainly wouldn't be coughing up a dime if that's the case. If you're looking to be paid to go away, or you're looking to be somehow rewarded for, quote, expressing your views, unquote, I'm sick of her and that behavior, which is so unseemly, so tacky, but so very Clinton. Billionaire ex-Republican Mike Bloomberg, who is now a Democrat running for president under the party's banner, is causing some rumbling in the ranks, as many Democrats see the moneyed man getting special treatment as a prize of the party. Take, for example, the party's changing of rules last week on who qualifies to participate in the party's debates. Many of the stringent requirements have been relaxed to accommodate Bloomberg, it seems, and insiders are saying they're fed up already, and he's just come aboard, with the party bosses just basically waiting on him hand and foot. They're giving him all kinds of incentives, you know, and as saying thanks for coming aboard. They know he's special because, of course, he's walking with some fat pockets, and they want to keep him happy. So to keep him happy, one of the things they did last week is change some of the rules about how the debates are going to run, how will people qualify to even get on the stage. He is having no problems at all, but other candidates apparently are having some difficulty that they didn't expect to have and they didn't have before. And by the way, some of the consequences for that have been rather severe. They've had to drop out of the race. They've had to disappear. And they've had to accept second best. When the rulings come down and they say, well, you can't be on the stage, you can't participate in the debate, it is a blow to many candidates, because that is how they're able to reach large audiences and impress them. with their plans and with their ideas, with their arguments that they're making against other Democrats. And if these new rules show themselves to be harsh and show themselves to be particularly prejudicial to the Democratic candidates, I think they have good reason to raise these questions. The idea being that nobody needs to say it. It is known, it is said, it is accepted that because he is walking in there prepared to spend billions, if it came to that, because he said that before, he's prepared to spend billions of dollars to defeat Trump. He is quite a catch for the Democratic Party. He is totally self-financed. And therefore, he makes his own rules. Or he gets to make his own rules. Or else he'll walk away and go someplace else that would embrace him and his billions. So there's some rumbling going on within the Democratic Party over this. And at some point, it would reach a high pitch because there's only so much in a very, very tight race, fraught with all kinds of problems. And the last thing they need is somebody coming in who used to be a Republican, now is a Democrat, but not really. He's not part of the pack. He's a Democrat, but he's his own person. He's running his own campaign. He's using his own money. In other words, he is simply renting a room from the Democrats to establish, you know, a kind of permanent address. I'm a Democrat, and if you don't believe me, here's the proof. So I think this is going to explode a little bit because what the complaining people are saying, and there are many complaining people, is that in effect Bloomberg has bought his way into the party, and it is clearly understood by all parties involved that he is to be given a lot of elastic, a lot of room to do what it is he wants to do. It may not necessarily jive with what everybody else wants to do, but it's the power of money. He's got a lot of money. And I saw a little clip of party bosses very clumsily trying to explain themselves around this question, trying to persuade everybody that no, there's no favoritism going on here. It's everybody having to toe the same line. Well, I don't think that's true. I don't think that's true. And I think they have a legitimate beef, as would be expected. I mean, this is how human nature works. Whatever people want to think, they were getting along as they got along, okay? But now there's a changing, changing rules caused principally by the inclusion of Bloomberg as a candidate within the ranks of the Democratic Party. I hope they figure it out, but it's not going to be easy, that's for sure. Because the party can't deny it, you see. They can't deny that Bloomberg has the upper hand. Bloomberg is calling his shots. He's not taking instructions from anybody because he doesn't have to. He's not depending on the party to deliver any special things to him, because he has the money to organize his own campaign, to organize his own support system. He doesn't need the Democratic Party. And I raised this question some time ago when he first announced the shift. He is going to pose this particular problem, because people will say, and they would have some grounds to say it, coming into the party the way he has, with a lot of money, gives him added privileges that other candidates will not enjoy. It's going to be a problem. So, on Wednesday, the Senate formally will vote on the final disposition of the impeachment case against President Donald Trump. Democrats think thin hope of getting witness testimony against Trump went up in flames, as you know, on Friday after Republicans blocked their efforts. It was a stunning defeat for Democrats, but it gave Trump a moment to triumphantly resume his presidential campaign. There's little doubt that Wednesday's vote overwhelmingly will favor acquittal for Trump, even though several senators see merit to the complex charges brought against him, the main two being abuse of power and obstruction of Congress. In what ways do you see the likely acquittal of Trump affecting U.S. politics? That's the question. So three topics I've thrown out to you. Feel free to react to them with your own particular interpretation or point of view. And we'll come back to your discussions right after this break at 888-874-4888. Stories on PRN.FM. I'm Eutrice Leed. The number is 888-874-4888. Three kind of developing stories, but we can't say we're surprised. You know, they've been lurking around, and it was going to be inevitable that they would become stories that should be discussed, because of the implications for the broader community. Eric from Brooklyn, you're on the air.
Hi.
Hello.
Hello, hello. It's been a while. Hello to the audience, the PRN audience.
Thank you.
I wanted to talk about the... I'm aligned with Clinton and I think David.
You're aligned with what? I'm sorry.
With the ideas of Clinton, I think it's Clinton, right? And David, who call in, you know, pretty regularly.
Oh, okay.
But, in this idea that it's very, to me, it's clear that the Democrats are intentionally not bringing forth the crimes of Trump. You know, they're moralizing. They want to, you know, they want to keep us in suspense in this state of some kind of moral resentment of Trump. But Trump's attitude towards is that we're irrelevant. You know, the American people are irrelevant. His interests and the interests of big business is what's relevant, is what needs to prevail. And the irony is that so are the Democrats. They have the same position. The people are irrelevant, right? They're only significant when they're needed to make a decision that, you know, that allows them to do what they want in terms of making money and maintaining power. Because the main crimes of any of these administrations is war. It's killing people. You know, killing people, and killing people entails so many other things.
Degradation of the environment, of the places they bomb, and the resources they use, and where they have to dig up the uranium, and where they have to dig up these fossil fuels, to invest all in all of this destruction.
But you're going a little broader than you need to. I wanted you to deal with the questions raised and respond to them.
Well, one of the questions, I came in a little late, but one of the questions was about Bloomberg, right?
Yes.
Okay. In terms of Bloomberg, it's sickening that I think there's little details that come out about stop and frisk and his treatment of people of color, especially, that people kind of gloss over, right? And the whole stop.
But look what he's done. Yeah. Look what he has done as a anticipating those very criticisms. Uh-huh. He has set aside, he said, $72 billion to invest in communities of color. Uh-huh. He's talked about, you know, he's apologized for stop and frisk. These were meant to give him a little bit of credibility within these two communities, especially Latinos and African Americans.
That's irrelevant. I don't care about his promises. You know, I don't, and I think people that hold their hat on the promises of these maniacs are just, they get what they deserve. You know, how many times can these people make us promises and do the exact opposite and keep getting reelected? You know, Bloomberg presided over a catastrophe in the economic environment, right? His main industry is analyzing Wall Street. You're there for 8 years, and after your 8 years, Wall Street collapses, and then you buy yourself four more years. And so, I mean, did you see it coming? Did you not see it coming? Did you allow it? And then
That pertains not so much to Bloomberg, but to the people who support him. Did you not see it coming?
And that's the problem. I mean, it's obvious that he made tons of money in that time period, you know? And so he allowed the destruction of the banking system and all the people that went down with it for profit, even though he was already a billionaire, right? So that shows you where his heart is at, you know, as it pertains to the people. He could care less about the people. But one quick thing about stop and frisk, right?
But no, but they we have to move on because we have a lot of people waiting.
I just want to say one thing.
I need to move on. Thank you so much, Eric, for your call. Ed from L.A., you're on the air.
I missed your question, but I have some takes on everything Bloomberg and Biden. Bloomberg said in 2016 that he was going to run if Bernie Sanders ran, and the word was that Bloomberg was very worried about Bernie Sanders' tax on the rich. At the time, he was going to have a 1% surcharge on all financial transactions on Wall Street. So I believe that Bloomberg is in the race now to keep Bernie out, and that's why Hillary's attacking Bernie. Bernie will never be the candidate for the Democratic Party. The setup and the fix is in, and you'll see after the Iowa caucuses that if he takes those in New Hampshire, you're going to see the attacks step up tremendously on Bernie. But I believe Bloomberg is in because Bernie's running, and he doesn't want Bernie to become president. It's specifically to keep Bernie out. That's why Bloomberg, you never see him. But I don't even know if he is a Democrat. You said he's running as a Democrat. He hasn't said what
he
was.
Running as a Democrat, yes.
In his ads, he doesn't say what he is, though. Or, you know, you see him with kids and you see him with people. The thing is, he's there really, I believe, to keep Bernie out. That's the whole purpose of the Democratic Party right now, is to either get Biden or maybe the two of them, B&B, to get those guys in, the two B&Bs. The two billionaires in the White House to protect the rich, to protect the corporations. This is neoliberalism. That's what the Democratic Party has really become. It's about quantitative easing. That's what Barack Obama did to the banks and the corporations. And then you got Trump. He comes in and he's get the tax cuts for the corporations. But meanwhile, Main Street is dying, while Wall Street gets corporate welfare and corporate bailouts. So that's my take on Bloomberg. I hope I answered your question. If I didn't, I apologize.
Yes, you did. But he said, and now I just want to ask you part B, if you could do it briefly. He said that the only reason that he's in the race is to defeat Trump.
Well, you know, you always have to be troubled about what someone's against unless you hear what they're for. So anytime somebody says, and I heard Bernie say this, and that's the other reason why I was sort of bothered by Bernie this year. He was asked on the campaign trail, why are you running this year? And he said, to stop Trump. If you don't say what you're for and you only say what you're against, that's a problem. And that was a problem in 2016 for the Democrats, too, because all they felt they had to do, really, was just say, hey, let's stop Trump. We don't have to say what we're for. I mean, Hillary said she gets things done. That's it. What does she get done? Take her clothes, husband's clothes to the cleaners? What? You know, so no one says what they're getting done. So there was no campaign slogan. So you can't just be against something. You have to be for something. And that's what we see here.
Well, thank you. Thanks for calling in and contributing.
Thank you.
Patricia from New York, you're on the air. How are you?
Good afternoon, you Trace, and good afternoon to the PRN family. You know, I was hoping those doggone Democrats would prove me wrong. If you remember a few months ago, I said that they were going to have a problem as the election cycle drew nearer, because their problems were going to be Warren and Sanders and how to handle them, how to manage them, how to make certain that they were not the nominees. So here we are now. D-Day has arrived. This morning I heard that not only is Mike Bloomberg in the pot, but now I hear that John Kerry is considering throwing his hat in the ring. John Kerry.
Absolutely, he is not running.
John Kerry is not going to run. That's what he says?
No, that's what he said.
Well, why was he even in the equation to begin with? Why did he have to deny the rumor? Who put the rumor out there?
You know how these things work. Sometimes these things come from, you know, behind the curtain, where people are encouraged to put, you know, the candidate's name or the person's name is into the mix as a candidate, only to have the candidate say, oh, I won't not run. Okay. I'm not thinking of running. When in fact they are.
Well, see, that's my point. The Democrats are literally doing the exact same thing they're accusing Trump and the Republicans of doing. And you see, they want to come across as being the responsible people, the ethical people, the moral people.
Yeah.
Yet still, they just happen to be more chaotic in their plans than the Republicans are. The Republicans are very organized, whereas they're disorganized. But the bottom line is, they are talking and playing the exact same game. And I'm not really quite sure if black and brown people do not look at this and come to some understanding. The minute they changed the rules to accommodate Bloomberg, the minute Bloomberg could say, look, I just need the line. I don't need you for anything else. I just need the line. Now, you can give me the line or not. You don't give me the line, I can go someplace else. In other words, he can go anywhere, write his own rules, do whatever he wants to do. He just decided it was easier for him to do it on the Democratic party line.
Yep. Absolutely.
So they've got a problem. They've got a problem. And the longer this goes on, the worse the problem's going to be. Because I think over time, people, and I certainly hope, I mean, I don't have a dog in this fight, but I like Julian Castro. I really did. In the debates, Julian Castro was the only one who was raising issues of black and brown people. And so I hope that folks literally continues to put this on the table, because they got some explaining to do.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you, Patricia.
Have a good evening.
So what do you really think? Thanks so much for your analysis. Marcus from Wisconsin, you're on the air.
Ms. Lee, thank you very much. How are you today?
Fine, thank you. How are you?
Good. Oh, I can't do a thing wrong. The question, as I understand it, was what will happen if Trump is not convicted, or if he is, what does it mean for the American polity and the economy, et cetera? It means the fascist program will continue. You have a very astute caller named David, I believe, who often brings up the actual name for what we suffer from, which is fascism. And the U.S. Army in 1945, in a fact sheet that they handed out to all the troops, defined fascism as government by the few for the few. Okay? That's what we've got. Anybody who will deny that is just not in the real world. So regardless of what happens to Trump, what it means is the society is run by the rich for the rich. They are your enemy, not the politicians who are just their stooges. So the fascism, the fascist program, and it's global now, will continue unimpeded regardless of what happens in the political system. When Alan Greenspan retired as the head of the Federal Reserve Bank years and years ago, he was interviewed in Forbes magazine. You can look it up. And he told the truth for a whole paragraph. They asked him at the time the Bush election was going on, you know, the second George Bush election. And they said, well, will the issues in the campaign affect Federal Reserve Bank policy? And he said, oh, no, you don't understand. Policy is insulated from politics. In other words, go have your little elections. We're the rich. We do what we want, regardless of what you do. What you do doesn't matter. It has no effect on anything. So what we have to do, if we want to do anything, is not obsess about political candidates. You had a previous caller who mentioned that Bernie Sanders hasn't got a chance because the Democrats would rather elect Trump than allow even a mild progressive who won't completely attend to the desires and prerogatives of the rich. Now, that's the real situation in your politics in the United States. Now, if you're going to change that, you're not going to do it through the electoral system or through gab. You're going to have to realize, number one, the rich are conducting a class war. It's a war to them. All you have to do is read the business press, the Business Week or the Wall Street Journal or any of it. They talk openly in vulgar Marxist class war terms against labor or the population or the working class in general. They know what they're doing. We don't. we're all obsessed with this little shadow puppet that the political system puts on for us. That's irrelevant. What matters is what the rich are doing. Now, they have actually openly, billionaires have openly taken over the political system, and the suckers are lining up to vote for them. Look, the problem is, here's part of what we have to realize, I believe, as whatever you want to call it, progressives.
Wrap it up a little bit, because we're getting close on time, and we have a couple of people still to speak.
This is my last comment.
Okay.
Thank you. And that is, we have to realize we're in a war. Now, a war is worth fighting or it isn't. But stop kidding yourself that you have any effect on what's going to happen to the political system.
Well, thank you. Points well made. Thank you very much. David from Brooklyn, you're on the air.
Yes, a number of people have touched on what I would usually talk about. So I'm going to sum it up this way. What is happening here is correct. The ruling class own the country. They own the politicians. And their mission is to enrich themselves at the expense of the masses of people. So all this stuff about, impeachment and all the activities going around with the so-called Democratic election and so forth with these the uniparty, that's one party with two divisions, is essentially what people in the quote-unquote education field would say is busy work for the students. When you don't know what to do with the students for a moment, or you want to be occupied with something else, you give them some busy work. So this campaign, these primaries and caucuses and elections, that's a good way of giving the people, that's the mass of the people, over 300 million, the idea that you're doing something. You keep them busy. You let them watch the football games. You let them be involved in all kinds of entertainment and the election. That's big news in terms of the election and the primary and whatnot, but that's nothing but busy work. The place is designed to benefit those at the top, period. This is a vulture capitalism that you have here. It's not the Scandinavian capitalism where they do have some social and economic benefits of people. So this is a big movement that they have to keep the people in check and to constantly trick them into believing, the masses of people, that they're in charge when they're not in charge at all. The ruling class is fully in charge and getting even better in terms of controlling the people and enriching themselves at the expense of everybody else.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much, David, for your contribution today. Jay from New York, you're on the air.
Yes, good afternoon, you three. Listen, when it comes down to money, as they say, bull, sugar, honey, iced tea talks and everything else walks. Remember, he gave the Democratic Party, I think it was $80 million a couple of months ago. So they know that even if he doesn't get the nominee, he's going to put millions and millions of dollars into their coffins. The thing that disturbs me most of all is this. Whenever donors put funds out there to the DNC, I always get upset and mad because so-called black strategists and other blacks who work for the party and media don't get a red cent or get a very, very small amount. But they lean so much on our vote. That's why I say this, and I hope someone would listen. All of the so-called black Democratic strategists need to come together in a room and put forward an agenda and a plan on how they're going to supposedly feed black voters and how they're going to be able to use them to move us forward as a community and a people. If we don't do that, we're going to be in big trouble and, as always, just going to be used by these Democrats. Because Tom Perez has done his thing against the black community for a long period of time. And the bottom line is we have to stand up against Tom Perez, because Tom Perez was the individual who basically came in and took Ellison out of the running for the president. And Ellison would have done a way better job.
All right. So when we go along this week, what should we be keeping in mind?
Well, keep in mind that we're being used, that we're not getting anything in return for our vote, and that we have to stand up against it. And we have to do something to hold these people accountable. Matter of fact, if the truth be told, Bloomberg ain't even supposed to be in the race. If I remember, if I'm not mistaken, the last time he held public office, he was a Republican as the mayor of New York. And you see what he did in New York, using his money also to give a third term, for what reason I will never know and never understand. The bottom line is, people are being used by the Democratic Party for what? And if we don't put forward the proper messaging on all types of things that are necessary to get Fredo out of office, this thing is not going to get no better. It's getting worse. This society is not getting better. And you have to blame the Democratic Party for it. To allow what the DNC has just done to the Cory Bookers, the Kamala Harris's, and the other minorities that was in the race over these last couple of months, to now all of a sudden, because money bags, they decide they want to be a part of this, could get rules changed? No, that's not right. That's not fair. And people should be up in arms about it and do something as a protest. But they got everybody supposedly so scared because of Fredo. It's crazy.
Well, thank you.
It's wrong. Have a
thanks
good day.
Thanks for your opinion. Willie from Brooklyn, you're on
good
the
afternoon.
Air, but not
good
with much
beloved.
Time.
Yeah, good
how
afternoon.
Are you?
Okay. Listen, but I just want to say something. Bloomberg is a lifetime member of ADASHAS, the Zionist group, women's Zionist group. So that alone should tell particular African people, because we know their philosophy, you know. So that's all I have to say.
No, but what is their philosophy, and why do you raise it?
You control the Congress and the money system, and now the president, you know. That's just, in my judgment, that's just too much control.
You're saying that Bloomberg controls the
not Bloomberg himself, but the Zionist. That is their philosophy. You know, it's a racist organization and criminal organization.
But it's very hard. I mean, it's very hard to say something like that.
No, yeah, but I looked at him. He is a member of the women's lifetime.
Yeah, so he's a member of a number of things. But I'm interested in how you make the leap from being a member of a group to now being in control of the economy and so forth.
Well, being president, that is very, very powerful, holding a very powerful position. You see what I'm saying? And they are, for example, the Obama, when Obama was president, Netanyahu came in the back door to address Congress to go against a policy that the president did not approve of.
Yeah, but we look where you are and look where we're supposed to be. You talk about Netanyahu and Obama. We're talking about the here and now.
Yes, that's what. Well, I'm saying, I would never vote for him, and I don't think any of us should vote for him. Particularly the experience we have with designers. Margaret Sangster was one of them, and the one of their policies was the extermination of black babies.
No. These are things that we have to be very careful about, because these are charges, very serious charges. And where is the proof?
Well, it's in the record about Margaret.
Which record?
The abortion with Margaret Sanger and aborting.
But really, look at the leaps you have made. You're making a lot of leaps
I'm saying that she was a Zionist.
Yeah, but we're not discussing Zionism. We're discussing the current political issues.
Yes.
We're not discussing Margaret Sangster or anybody else. We're not discussing that. Because when you get yourself in these discussions, you find that you find yourself bringing in a lot of things that are not tested, that are not proven, and in fact are theories put out there in order to fuel anti-Jewish sentiment. And that's not right.
No.
If there's a legitimate argument about it, fine. But we're talking, I don't know how you made the leap from
you three,
where we are to back then.
I'm not anti anybody. So please don't say I'm anti-Jewish. I'm talking about these Zionists. They're two different things, the Zionist organization and Jewish people.
Yes, you were talking about things that have nothing to do with our discussion today. Our discussion today is not about Zionists or Zionism. Our discussion today is about the current political situation. And I raised three particular examples that are dominating the national attention. Zionism is not one. So we want to stay on point. Another day we'll take on Zionism, because it needs to be taken on. That's for sure. But thanks for calling and contributing today. Thank you all for contributing. And it is very, very important to feel okay, to feel at ease, to feel, in fact, comfortable with the idea of expressing your thoughts and your views. Stay tuned. More stuff on prn.fm, and we'll see each other tomorrow. Bye-bye.